Testing.
Good afternoon. This is one of the talks you've all been waiting for. Can we have some... Actually, you've been waiting for a lot of talks, but this is like one of the highlights. I'm proud to introduce Vivian Lesnick-Weissman, a lawyer and a filmmaker, documentary filmmaker. Her new film, The Hacker Wars, it's about the targeting of hacktivists by the United States government. And she will be having a conversation here on stage with Thomas Drake, a renowned NSA whistleblower who was persecuted and prosecuted unsuccessfully, fortunately. He called their bluff and he walked away. So let me introduce Thomas Drake and Vivian Lesnick-Weissman.
Tom has been very generous with his time. I've interviewed him for many, many hours. I'm very honored to be on stage with him. I'm going to show some clips from the film and we'll have time for some questions too. So,
there is a congruence between whistleblowing and hacktivism and hacktivists. The similarity is speaking truth to and of power, revealing the power structure, whether it's corporate, whether it's government, or both.
I was a senior executive at the National Security Agency, and I served there for about 6.5 years. I blew the whistle on the secret surveillance program called Stellar Wind, which were the foundational surveillance programs that ultimately Edward Snowden, 12 years later, is now disclosing through reporters and journalists. The government went ahead and prosecuted me under the Espionage Act. It was a 10 felony count indictment. I faced 35 years in prison.
Thomas, can you tell us what it was that you learned at the NSA? You were a contractor there for 12 years, and then on 9/11, you became an employee with a very high post with all access. And what did you see there that prompted you to blow the whistle?
As a government employee, you take an oath to support and defend the Constitution. It's important to say that, the idea of how to govern ourselves. And for all its faults and foibles, it was a grand experiment that was launched in the late 18th century in this country after a violent revolution and against the British Crown. And that oath is simply to support and defend it. It's not an oath to secrecy. It's not an oath to the president. It's not an oath to NSA. It's an oath to the Constitution. And 9/11 was a trigger event that led the government at the highest levels, up to and including former Vice President Cheney and President Bush, to approve a number of different programs, some of which we still do not know the full extent of in spite of the Snowden disclosures. And much to my horror, having grown up in the 1970s as a very young teenager, witnessing the resignation of a president from his office, Watergate, that's when I was first introduced to as a civil, you know, liberties and civic studies and the history of the Pentagon Papers, the bright and shining lie called Vietnam, Ellsberg facing trial as the first whistleblower charged on the Espionage Act. And also finding out that no one is above the law, no one is above the Constitution, even the president said so. And the horrors of what was possible, I was now confronted by in secret, because right after 9/11, word went out from the White House that the National Security Agency had been given presidential authorization to turn the United States of America into the equivalent of a foreign nation for the purposes of dragnet electronic surveillance on an extraordinary scale. It didn't matter what had happened in the 70s. It didn't matter that there was a law called the Constitution. It didn't matter that if you want to change the law, you go to Congress. None of that mattered. This was raw executive power taking control of the government from inside out. And no one knew about it except for a small handful. The surveillance programs that were launched after 9/11 are still considered secret by the US government. And those surveillance programs were designed specifically to collect as much information as possible, no matter what its source. And I was confronted by the dark abyss of the Pandora's box opened up, staring into the past and now the future. And I knew that these decisions would have enormous consequences. You could not unleash a military intelligence agency that was signed by the stroke of a pen in the deepest of secrecy in 1952, not created by any congressional legislation, headed by a military general, reporting directly in terms of the chain of command to the president as commander in chief, and take all that power and turn it on its own country without something giving. And I knew that if I remained silent in those first few weeks after 9/11, when I discovered all this, that I would be complicit in a crime, and I could not remain silent when my own government was now a criminal enterprise subverting the Constitution of the United States. And so I made a choice within the system over a number of years. Some have questioned me in having continued to remain within the system all those years, to fight them with everything I knew that was available to me in terms of bringing this to light. And it turned out that that was a long and arduous story, which we will probably get into a little bit. But here I was facing the reality, the stark reality, that our own government had, the wheels had come off our own government. And not only were we, had the wheels come off, we were in an entirely different vehicle, an anathema form of government. And as I've told Ellsberg and others, what I was confronted by was the United States was operating under emergency decree, the equivalent of martial law. I'm going to use really strong language during this hour here. I really am, because I'm afraid that most people still don't get it. I really am. And it's not just the government, but it's also a huge sector of American the corporate environment and the corporate economy. We're going to get talk about that, because there's our very sovereignty, is not just as a nation, but as individuals, is at stake. And you know, I don't want society becoming like Winston in 1984, where the only place that Winston had any kind of security, to say it that way, was in the corner, outside the constant gaze of the video cameras, which meant they knew where he was. And I've lived this. I've lived this in a way, and I was able to come through it, and I'm sitting in front of you, all the hundreds of you out there, as a free human being. I can't begin to tell you what it means to be free when the government spent many, many years doing everything it could to take away the very heart of what it means to be a sovereign human being and put me in prison for as long as they could. What it means to actually be free. You really begin to focus on what matters in life. And so I don't have a whole lot of sympathy for people that try to apologize for this. I don't have a whole lot of sympathy for people who try to give the government the benefit of the doubt. It's important to note that after 9/11, we were essentially put under emergency law by the executive, and there was no constitution.
So you documented in your case the surveillance state up to that point. If we had really paid attention to what you were saying, we might not be where we are now. The surveillance state's already here.
Well, see, the kicker is I went to everybody that Justin Radak said earlier. I went to every channel that existed, including serving as a material witness over a period of months during 2002, including a joint inquiry, giving prima facie evidence of the surveillance programs, particularly Stellar Wind, the failure of 9/11, as well as a cover-up and the massive fraud, waste, and abuse, billions and billions being spent in the name of security. And it's important to note that my moment of truth was actually the first week in October of 2001. Now, this is barely 3 weeks after 9/11. I confronted the lead attorney at NSA. He actually showed up in the recent Frontline documentary called The United States of Secrets. And he said, "You don't understand, Mr. Drake." This is after he acknowledged that the White House had approved what they called the program, the President's Surveillance Program. It was always called the program. So you understand, we just need the data. We just need the data. And see, when he said that, I was thrown back to a period in my other life, my other day job, when I was a crypto linguist flying on RC-135s during the Cold War in the European theater. And what country did I become an expert in? What country did I spend many, many years listening in on their communications? East Germany. It was just a very surreal moment, because now I'm realizing that on a far vaster scale, that my own government is now deciding that in the interest of national security, we're just going to collect it all. We need to know everything there is to know about anybody, at any time, anywhere. And we have the platform to do it. That's what's called internet. And all the telephone systems.
To what end? To what end is this security surveillance state?
It's ultimately about social control. Let no one be naive to believe that somehow there's a morality in collecting all this information and it won't be used for other purposes. And that's precisely what the government is doing.
And if anyone stands up to the power structure like a hacktivist or a whistleblower, they don't just indict you, they try to destroy you. This is what they tried to do to you.
Yeah, it's, what does it mean to have your life destroyed? Okay, just imagine each of you as sovereign human beings coming under the purview of the government as a person of interest and then becoming a target of the government. The government has decided that you're an enemy of the state. And imagine that they have the highest power microscope, a digital microscope, and they spend 4 years drilling down into your life. Everything there is to know about you, what will they find out? And how could they use it against you? How could they manipulate facts, let's say facts about your life, especially when they want to punish you, especially when they want to put you away, as I was. See, I faced a certain reality when the original chief prosecutor came to me in April 2008, before I actually resigned from NSA. And he said, "Mr. Drake, how would you like to spend the rest of your life in prison unless you cooperate with our investigation?" This is how far the government was willing to go to protect national secrets. There was no way they were going to let someone like me and others, but at that time I was the target of their multi-year, multi-million dollar investigation in terms of who had leaked information about the Stellar Wind program to the New York Times, James Rise and Eric Lichtblau. And they were hell-bent to punish somebody. I found out from very deep sources within the government that Cheney had issued a direct edict: find and fry the perpetrators. I don't care who they are, make an object lesson of them, burn them.
Right.
And so when you're on the receiving end of the government with all the powers they have in terms of surveillance and the FBI, they can make life extraordinarily difficult. And so I was made a person of interest in 2006, and I experienced severe electronic surveillance and physical surveillance. I ultimately had FBI agents tailing me no matter where I went, just to make sure they kept track of me. What can I tell you? I mean, it's, you know, I don't think, and I keep talking about this in public, and every time I tell the story, people start to appreciate what it's like if the government decides to destroy you. It's not, look, I listened in on East German state. I was very familiar with the Stasi and the police state and what they did to isolate and fragment people's lives, okay? Listening in on the lives of others, literally, where they had the entire telephone system designed for surveillance. That's precisely what's happened in this country.
I have another clip, which is of three hacktivists that were targeted, and they've tried to destroy them as well. And I think that we'll go back and forth between your story and the story of the hacktivists, because I think we found a lot of analogous situations.
Look, you don't speak truth to power. You know, you don't poke the bear in the eye with a stick, right? You don't hold up a mirror and expose government criminality. Government criminality without them reacting to it. And so, yeah, I found myself behind several eight balls in 2008, and it took them a couple years, and it was the Obama administration, to figure out how to charge me under the Espionage Act.
Anonymous.
Cyber attacks.
And new kind of warfare.
Hackers and activists.
Security leaks.
Computer hackers.
Hackers.
Activists.
Anonymous has struck again with a warning. This is just the beginning.
Anonymous is a collective known for recent attacks on government and corporate websites.
The internet is a powerful new medium where just a handful of people in small groups, just by shifting data around in the right directions, can make big changes and big damage.
The more you said, the more frightening it was.
The Pentagon is now singling out Anonymous as an example of the serious new cyber threats facing the country.
The fundamental unit here is information warfare.
We're gaining back the freedom that the forefathers ensured us through technology, and we can't allow these freedoms to be taken away. I will put my body on the altar of liberty again and again and again.
Information is the weapon, and information properly understood and properly used in an honest way is more effective than anything else in the world.
If you've got your eye on Boeing, yeah, please go for it. I'd like to see those fuckers go down. Download the code, modify the code just a bit, bombard the Pentagon. You are either with us or you're against us.
So the Obama administration and the DOJ have gone after whistleblowers and hackers with phenomenal vengeance. We're not going to talk too much about Barrett Brown because there was a panel earlier and there will be another one tomorrow, so we're going to focus a little bit more on both Weave and Hammond. But in general, the whistleblower and the hacktivists from the outside, the whistleblower from the inside, they share many traits. And can you expand on that?
Look, there was information that I had access to when I was in the government. And it was crystal clear that what I discovered in terms of government criminality, massive fraud, waste, and abuse, and threats literally to public safety deserve to be free and made available to the public so they could be informed. And though I went the first few years, I went through government channels, I ultimately did make a fateful decision. In very early 2006, I went to a Baltimore Sun reporter with what I knew. But I knew that by going to this reporter, particularly with this leak investigation going on, that I would not only jeopardize my job, but I could find myself on a really short end of a stick and being charged with far worse. I actually knew that. And yet, it was not about me. It was about what was in the greater interest for the public and what was at stake. And so that was a choice I made. I mean, that was, you know, we all have moral agency, and I chose to exercise that moral agency. One of the mottos that I continue to live by is you question everything, but especially authority. There's this weird thing now, this pathological transformation of government of, for, and by the people into simply we're the authority. And because we're the authority, and we have the power, you dare question us, we're going to make sure you remain silent. Or we're going to make it so difficult that we're going to send the most chilling a message to anybody else who would dare question us. And that's precisely what's happening in this country. And this is these are strategic decisions that the government is making in all of these cases. They want to set an example for others.
They also want to control the narrative. And whistleblowers and hacktivists are the narrative escapes from them. They can't control. And also, the courageous ones, the truth tellers, whether they're hacktivists or whistleblowers, you're willing to go to prison. That's a very rare, and it really breaks down the whole security system, because that's a sea change. People don't want to go to prison. They're just human, and they want to live their lives with their families. But you and the hacktivists and the ones in my film all say, well, we knew we were going to prison. So what do you do with people like that? People who are willing to stand up for what they believe in, people who believe in the Constitution, the real patriots are the people in this film and yourself, against the security surveillance state. What does a state do with you? Well, we've seen what they do.
Look, you don't do what Edward Snowden did. You don't do what Jeremy did. You don't do what Weave did. You don't do what Barrett Brown did, right? Especially in this climate, you don't do what I did or Bill Binney and others without the government saying, you know what, you're a direct threat because you're not playing by the rules. See, but these rules don't mean anything to the government. I am a prime example. I was actually considered to be the example the government was going to establish and prop me out on the public comm and say, this is what happens when you question us. This is what happens when you decide to expose information in the public interest. This is what happens because you betrayed the system. You betrayed the system. And those who dare dissent in that manner, those who dare raise their voices against authority, are the most dangerous kind in this kind of regime. And so, not just the government, but even corporations in partnership or in bed with the government. See, I gave a speech, if anybody wants, you can do a search on it. It was at the Web 2.0 summit in San Francisco, not long after I had pleaded guilty to exceeding authorized use of a computer under the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. I was invited to give a talk, and I took on both the government as well as the corporations. And I know people are made very uncomfortable because, see, all of this in the information economy is being used against us. All these services, right, is data of who you are is very valuable, and the more the better. And so you have just not just the government surveilling, but you have the corporations are surveilling you as well, and then selling services back to you. And then they're giving back doors on an extraordinary scale, a scale it's still not fully revealed. I keep saying that. I'm hoping there's more disclosures in what's come out from Edward Snowden, how far this regime has gone, fully penetrating the entire infrastructure of our modern society on a scale the world and history has never seen before. But see, this is all in the background. This is all embedded. And, you know, we're lulled into this matrix mentality, right? That somehow we can protect ourselves. Really. For those of you, especially in this audience, right? You know, deep packet inspection, I'll just throw that out there. When you actually build in surveillance by design, it makes it extraordinarily difficult. That's why anonymization becomes even more important in this space. Now you're sort of in this, you know, who can out anonymize the other in a cat and mouse game and all those. I spend many, many hours helping people, critical people, people that are defending people like myself and others, completely pro bono, setting them up with systems that at least they have some reasonable expectation that they can communicate in a way that maybe the government will know exactly what they're saying at the time they say it, with no guarantees.
I want to show a clip from a case that I think everyone in this room is familiar with, and Thomas and I spoke about it. We were actually with him last night.
It's not scary to be going to prison?
No, I never was scary to be going to prison. There's all these cool people, and I'm learning all these cool things, and you know, I'm making lifelong future friends, and you know, it's a future business partner, certainly.
embarrassing people. I enjoy it. It's viscerally fun.
He's an instigator.
The most lovable little pest on the internet.
His ability to make other people so angry is the talent that he has.
Little Weave is going to troll the fuck out of Apple and AT&T.
How do I plan on keeping my cornbread safe in prison? I will stab a nigger that dares reach across my plate. I am the Bruce Lee of RegXP. I didn't get caught. I put my name on what I did. I'm not here to play nice with AT&T. I'm here to comment and criticize. There was a URL on an AT&T web server with a number at the end. And if you had add one to this number, like you could have typed it in the iPad web browser over and over again, you would see the next iPad 3G user email address.
So we was convicted to 41 months, the top of the guidelines, CFAA violations for adding one to a number. What do you think, Thomas?
Pretty ridiculous, isn't it? You know, it's funny seeing this again because, and then it's not so funny. I used to be in the software development and coding arena. I was a certified software test engineer for a number of years. I've analyzed hundreds of millions of lines of code back in my day. And we used to look for hidden channels, covert channels, back doors. You know, this is the space of the digital age. And why? Because we're increasingly reliant on these very systems. And, you know, what does it mean with a government is actually has a state-sponsored program to ensure that the electronic infrastructure society is as weak and as insecure as possible. What does it tell you? Now the government is actually the enemy, isn't it? Well, they turned me into an enemy of the state. It was all power projection. And so
your crimes were similar because we've basically embarrassed AT&T. And in the end, you didn't have any classified information that you revealed, but you certainly embarrassed the NSA.
Yeah, and it's really interesting psychologically when you make an institution look bad. So, to save their face, they're going to spite you. And that's precisely what happened to me. I mean, I remember, it's, you don't spend a lifetime as I did in various capacities, military in the Cold War, as a contractor. I did a lot of consulting in Silicon Valley. I mean, it's funny. I remember when I was a virtual member of the Chaos Computer Club in the 1980s. Those were really innocent days now when I look back on them. There wasn't all these dark shadows about what could be. It was you had this, the ethics of anything you discovered or found, you would share. And it was really cool. And you had clubs and you got together and you had dinners and families chatted, and you did all kinds of things like that together, and it was all this new technology. My first computer was an Atari 800. It was really, really a moment when I was being severely interrogated by the FBI willingly in my house in November of 2007 when they showed up with a dozen FBI agents that were armed, and they tossed my house, and one of the technicians was coming up from this. I have all kinds of legacy equipment, okay? So it was really funny because I'm seeing, like, you know, 300 baud acoustic modems being confiscated by the FBI, and I had this highly modified. I used to be, I'm gonna like reveal myself here and come out of the hacker closet in part. I used to do hardware hacking. I mean, that was a big deal. You know, I remember sitting around a kitchen table with a friend, so we had that, we were down to our last EEPROM, right? And if we didn't burn it correctly, you know, we'd fry our Atari 810 disk drive, right? All of 90K that it was at the time, right?
So he's coming up the stairs with one of my highly modified Atari 8-bit computers, and I looked at him. I said, do you really need that? I mean, it was like a museum piece, right? It was like a one-off. There weren't many of these around. And I said, you know, that was an operating system designed in 1978 and 79, 10K operating system. It hasn't been modified for, you know, like 30 years. Right? You really need that? And he said, no, I guess not. And he actually went back down the stairs and put it on the shelf. Yeah.
We always knew you were a hacker, Tom.
Yeah. At heart, yes.
I want to show one more clip, but it's the... Hey, sorry. I get nervous. Whenever drinks.
Just know that information is power. If they hold it on you, like they did with me. You know, I just so you know, they manipulated information. I said I was data framed, literally. They had evidence that they claimed was extremely sensitive information. It was very top secret. And that this gravely damaged the national security of the United States. And I knew during my pretrial criminal proceedings, they had doctored it. They had doctored the evidence. Literally modified the header information on the document to make it look like it was classified when it wasn't. That's how far they went.
And then when they declassified something, they said that you should have known that it was actually classified.
Yeah, I mean, this is Kafkaesque. I mean, that's right. I should have known that it was classified even when it wasn't, even though they actually had an affidavit from their own people that it was actually unclassified.
Can you tell us the infinitely quotable, I do not bargain with the truth, when that came about, when you said that, when they offered you a deal?
Well, they offered many, many deals. So I was sharing this with Vivian just last night over dinner. And when I was originally confronted as a person of interest and now a target of a criminal investigation, the chief prosecutor said, threatened me with spending the rest of my life in prison. And if I actually pled out in 2008, that maybe it would be 35 years or less. Maybe. That's a pretty good deal, right? A year later, in May of 2009, I was at a conference in Arizona, and I had a private attorney who I was spending tens of thousands of dollars on to defend me against the government. So this is a year later, and he said, there's another plea framework, no guarantees, but it looks like they're going to come down from, you know, 25, 35 years to maybe 15 to 17. Much better deal, right? And I kept saying, if you have the evidence to convict me before a jury of my, then bring the charges on. Just bring them on. I was not going to plead out to something I didn't do. And I literally told the original chief prosecutor I would not plea bargain with the truth. But I didn't know that. It was no certainty in my case that the truth was going to matter with them, because it didn't. It's only what they could get away with. So then we get to the 2010 when I was secretly charged. Now, it's important for you to know just how much resources the government put into my case. I was actually in New York City clearing my head, attempting to do so. In April of 2008, and I get a phone call from one of the FBI agents, who was the contact person. This is before I actually had a private attorney. And she said, "We need you to come back down to one of our facilities." Well, this is one of those sensitive compartmented information facilities that Jesslyn Radak mentioned in her talk. And it's in the greater Washington, D.C. area, and it's a black room. It's got one door that comes in and out. And I'm walking in, and guess what I'm noticing? I'm seeing agents' cubicles, and they actually have a label, one of those little name tags, and it says Mole Hunter. The Mole Hunter unit is actually well known within the FBI, but this is the unit that doesn't go after truth tellers and whistleblowers or hacktivists. This is the one ostensibly is trained to go after real spies. That's how egregious they considered me. This is how far they had painted me into the black shadows. They were sicking key elements, lead FBI agents from this Mole Hunter unit. It reminds me of Spy Hunter, one of the old classic games. And I was hunted. You know, it's sort of weird. I mean, having played a lot of the classic games, remember, that was the other nice thing about all the golden era of computing. There's a lot of extraordinarily cool games to play when you weren't coding and hacking and doing other things, right?
I want to bring this fellow into the conversation. Infamous anonymous hacker Jeremy Hammond, number one on the FBI cybercrime list, pled guilty to Christmas hacking.
10 años de prisión a Jeremy Hammond.
Known as the electronic Robin Hood.
Jeremy Hammond.
Computer hacker Jeremy Hammond has been sentenced to 10 years in prison.
Hammond's actions are acts of civil disobedience. Fundamentally.
Could you elaborate on that?
Look, I'm going to say something that's really serious about this because this reminds me in terms of what Jeremy Hammond did. It was an extraordinary service to actually hack the Strat for emails and for Project PM, because one of the things I discovered at NSA during as this surveillance state regime metastasized and became a cancer on the body politic, a cancer on the Constitution. NSA had extraordinary deep relationships with traditional IT companies and telcos like AT&T and Verizon, right? But one of the things they developed is you had these specialized companies, revolving door, that were using information that was collected by the government, secrecy and surveillance apparatus, and then passing it on to their clients to leverage. Remember, information is power. So now you're not only do you have a mass surveillance state, but you're now repurposing what ostensibly was, you know, intelligence information, and you're repurposing in the form of economic and industrial espionage. And you're selling secrets to others because it's worth a lot of money, or you're selling influence, or you're buying influence. It's important to know this. And I understand why the government was really ticked at Jeremy. I really understand and appreciate why they would want to hammer him as hard as they could with everything they had in their arsenal. Because he was revealing a state secret, something that I actually shared with the 9/11 congressional investigators. But see, all of my material evidence in terms of secret surveillance, the industrial espionage, the relationships with a number of US-based corporations and overseas subsidiaries was all considered so secret as a state secret that it couldn't even end up in the secret report of the 9/11 investigations. It was all censored and suppressed. In fact, for years now, and it's been renewed in the last year, there are people working on my behalf and independently attempting to even locate the thousands of pages of documentation that I actually gave these investigators, as well as hours of oral testimony. They cannot find any record of any of this. Apparently, it's all been disappeared in the archives. Sort of the Indiana Jones warehouse, you know. There's an NSA version of it, by the way. That's actually where Thin Thread ended up, okay? Yeah. It went into the Indiana Jones digital warehouse, never to be seen again. So it's really important to understand at the highest levels, when you combine the government with these corporations who are now utilizing the information, or you have essentially intelligence companies that specialize in brokering intelligence that is provided to them by the government at the highest levels, what does that do? And what form of government is that? It's certainly not the form of government I took an oath to support and defend. But now I'm finding out that my own government is a clear and compelling danger to the Constitution, that it is in fact a domestic enemy of the Constitution, not just foreign.
So when the hackers, hacktivists, and the whistleblowers reveal criminality and they break a law, what Jeremy did was a violation of the law. It was illegal, but it was right. When our government, our legal system, unchains from principle and what's right and just latches onto a law to punish, to destroy the lives of people like yourself and Jeremy and Barrett Brown, I mean, it's the demise of the rule of law. I mean, we have laws, the Third Reich had laws, but
that means we're no longer citizens with rights. We have no inalienable rights. There is no right of life or liberty or the pursuit of happiness. You have no sovereignty. It's only what privilege is given to you by the state. Really. You know, we've been there in history. It's not kind. And yet the power that's available to the government and these corporations is extraordinarily enormous. But that means that, in essence, the government itself has become the outlaw, truth be told. And those who would violate certain laws or allegedly violate certain laws, and those are the ones that are turned into the criminal, should tell you how far this government has gone. I mean, it really, if you no longer can, remember, the government is us, but if the government is now acting in its own self-interest, and it's now acting out of its own power, and the pathology of then using that power to hammer you, or those who would question what it's doing, we've gone far down the pike of in this dark thread of history. And history's not kind at all. I mean, it was extremely personal for me on a recent trip to Berlin, where I actually visited the Stasi headquarters, as well as their secret prison system, one of them, and as well as their archives. Standing there in the archives, seeing umpteen row upon row upon row of files, this incredibly... Just reality reminding us what's at stake here. The voice of truth, yeah. Standing there, seeing all of these records of people and this incredibly sophisticated file, paper-based system, file-based indexing scheme to keep track of as many people as possible and what their affiliation is. They were the protectors. The Stasi were the protectors of the state and the party. Think about what's happening in this country. Who are they protecting? You know, I mean, I don't want to go
back. Who are they protecting?
I don't want to go back to a Middle Ages where, you know, you have all these, you know, moated communities and the power elites and everybody else is on the outside with the breadcrumbs. I mean, that's, you know, that's an extraordinary unequal power relationship. And we know what happens in history in terms of what that means. You know, you become a serf. You know, you become a subject of the state, not a citizen of the state.
In that first clip that I showed, there was a lot of media hype around Anonymous. The government, the FBI, has moved online in this new theater, and it's very important that there's hype and fear, and it's the same thing that fuels, you know, don't see something, say something. We have to always be in fear, and now we have to be in fear of the hackers because they're going to destroy the world, take down the electronic grid, the power structure, you know, all, you know, it'll be the end of the world if we don't control the internet, the hackers. It seems like the way they're coming down on hackers is disproportionate to their violations of law.
Look, they interviewed a former Stasi officer in an organization I was very familiar with from the Cold War. And they said it's naive to believe that all of this information is being collected on such a vast scale. It's simply being done so for the purpose of national security. It's not. It's under being done in the name of national security. See, I've said national security has become the state religion. And the priests of the secret information, right, hold that and protect it. They interpret it. They don't let anybody into the inner sanctums. It really is that level.
So why do they want to know everything?
See, they've actually said why. When I was at NSA, General Hayden, in executive session, would say, we just need to own the net. We need to know what anybody is doing at any time, anywhere, under any circumstance. The only way they can do that is create a mass surveillance regime. That's the only way. And so by collecting it all as a Stasi, it's the equivalent of the Stasi model. In order to know everything, we have to collect it all. And these former Stasi officers have said they're going to use this for social control, because the fact that they have this much information means they can use it for other purposes. Bill Binney himself is called, there is this weird legal term called parallel construction, where you repurpose the intelligence. You collect it under the guise of national security, and you repurpose it for law enforcement, which means you're in complete violation of due process because you have no probable cause. You're simply targeting everything. Well, if you target everything, that means you're simply making the haystack bigger. And I grew up on a farm. That's like cutting every field, all the hay, piling all the hay in the barn, and every straw becomes a needle. How do you find the needle? There is no needle to be found, because the purpose was you're simply harvesting the data on an extraordinary scale because you need to know. And I said, NSA is absolutely pathologically obsessed. Have any of you seen these shows about hoarders?
About what?
Hoarders. People where they can't even move in their own house, where they fill their homes up with all kinds of stuff. It's a psychological thing. It's somehow, if I get enough stuff around me, then that's me, right? And they keep projecting it, and they keep stuffing more stuff into their house until there's no room left. This is precisely the case with NSA, and I say this somewhat tongue-in-cheek. On the other hand, NSA was always a technical collection agency. So you can imagine the pathological response. They failed 9/11, although I recognize it was a trigger event, and there's a whole lot of things that they should have known about and didn't. Another part of my whistleblowing is we could have actually prevented 9/11. Truth be told, that's part of the real cover-up. But all this information is to compensate for the failure of not knowing. So as I was told by that lead attorney, we just need to get the data. It was always about the data. That somehow the data, so you can imagine if you're revealing the state secret of a mass surveillance regime where they just want access to all the data, or through your corporate partners.
Yes.
We can't forget the corporate partners. NSA cannot, or the FBI, or a number of other intel agencies, cannot do what they're doing without direct relationships and partnerships with the corporate side.
Well, wasn't that part of the Thin Thread versus Stellar Wind Trailblazer? I mean, it was, because there was millions and millions and billions of dollars at stake with the contractors versus the very small, efficient NSA program.
I was told by my immediate superior, who was the number three person that I reported to at NSA, who do I piss off? A dozen people in Thin Thread, or the hundreds and hundreds and billions and billions of dollars in contracts under what they called SIGINT programs? The answer was obvious. It didn't matter that Thin Thread fundamentally protected the sovereign rights of citizens no matter where they were, not just US citizens, by the way. This is another meme that somehow US citizens are superior to any other person or citizen in the world. I absolutely reject that notion. Period. There is no special American exceptionalism. It's somehow America is immune from history. It's not. What you're seeing are the entrails of empire, and the last time I checked, all empires end up in the dustbin of history.
It's interesting that the press hasn't really focused very much on the Stratford reveals. We have at least two journalists here that have very much focused on it, Doug Lucas being one of them, Joe Fiondo. Del Cameron, well, several, but they're in smaller publications. But the Stratford reveals are just completely the most morally debased criminality that our government could participate in. Just to mention one of them was a Stratford email that was in that dump that Hammond was responsible for hacking into Stratford, said that the DEA had asked permission to assassinate El Chapo, the leader of the Sinaloa cartel. So can you imagine what would happen if the U.S. government was involved in assassinating a cartel leader? That would be the failed state. The border states would be turned into what's going on in the gang wars of Mexico. There's just one after another. I mean, that's just the one that comes to mind. But there was so much criminality. To think there's a woman in India, a Bhopal activist, that has an altar to Jeremy Hammond because she couldn't believe that he was in jail for 10 years when what he revealed was that Stratford was spying on the Bhopal activists for Dow Chemical so they could evade their responsibility for a spill that killed thousands of people. So it comes back to, like, yeah, he broke the law, but we're on the wrong side of every issue here. The government is. They should be praising him and castigating Stratfor and the government, but that's not what's going on. I wanted to show one more clip because this is really, to me, one of the things that Thomas Drake says, that the hacktivist cases are very much about fundamentally First Amendment cases. To show this.
Infamous computer hacker known by his alias Weave is a free man after more than a year behind bars. An appeals court has now overturned his conviction.
So this case is at every step of the way, from the initial criminal complaint to my time in prison. It has always been about my speech, and they've wanted to silence me. They further punished me in prison and subjected me to conditions above and beyond any other of the prisoners at my facility because of my speech. They wanted me to disappear from public view and memory. It was inside the shoe. Inside the shoe.
So we've spent 7 months of his 14 months in isolation. The UN has said that U.S. solitary confinement is torture. No one else in his low minimum security facility spent more than several days at a time in the shoe. So they really came down on him. They want to destroy him. They want to destroy these truth tellers, the hacktivists, the people that threaten the status quo. It's the demise of the rule of law, unchained from the Constitution, Thomas.
They simply want to extinguish those who would dare question power and authority. Extinguish the very essence of what it means to be a human being. It's why I absolutely will not yield. I will not bend to those who would dare take our sovereignty away, because that's what's at stake. And it's why I've dedicated the rest of my life to defending life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, because those are inalienable rights for every single human being across the globe.
Thank you. It's an honor to have shared a stage with you.
Outside the room, there's another big talk is coming. Can you go downstairs? You want to set up a different. Mr. Drake, we're going to take you to the back service hall. You can talk and trust out there. Okay? All right.
Dell, are you here?
We need another.
Mike, I just want to say, everybody who just saw this talk, if you'd like to participate in a Q&A with Thomas Drake, downstairs in the mezzanine level near Radio Statler, he'll be available for Q&A. I think that's worthwhile, but not to detract from the upcoming talk. The press area, which is right near Radio Statler. With us as we set up. Get your seats. We'll be set up in a moment. Thank you for waiting. We're setting up a special camera so you can see the locks being picked real up close. It'll just take another minute.
Sound guy, you got anything or no? While you're waiting, please remember to have your cell phone ringers turned off. And along the aisles here, it doesn't seem not much of a crowd in the aisles, which is good. But just stay out of the fire lanes. Appreciate it. We have six times as much set up here because we have six panelists, a huge panel, a lot of information to cover about lockpicking. And we're just about set up. Yes. Focus. All right, I'm going to do some a couple of questions before we get set up here. How many of you folks have ever attempted to open a lock without a key? Wow, it's like half the room. All right, so a lot of you may not need a primer in lock picking, but there's always little details that we might not have missed because lock picking is and manipulating locks is a kind of a self-taught thing. So people learn on their own, and other people may not have picked up something you picked up or the other way around. So they're going to cover like a lot of little things that you may not have ever picked up on. And if you've never opened a lock without a key before, you're going to learn a whole lot more. So now we have all kinds of audio and video. And this one's already working. Good. Are we good?
Yeah, we're good.
All right.
All right.
Finally.
He's ready to have fun. So I'm going to start by introducing myself.
You want to introduce yourselves, or you can probably pronounce your own names better than me. Lockpicking, a primer.
So this is a three-hour panel slash intro. We will be taking a break at about an hour and a half. That's a little bit different than what the schedule says, but bear with us. This format is going to allow us to cover quite a bit of material in a short period of time and really engage a lot of you, so I think it's going to be fun. My name is Doug Farr. I'm president of LockSport International. We are similar to the group Tool, which many members are sitting up here with me. We are around almost as long as they have been. We kind of do the same stuff that they do, but we'll touch on more of that later. So
you just look damn sexy. You're doing it, don't you?
Oh, thank you. That's how I've been getting our membership base up. Promising my, never mind.
Jagor.
Hi, I'm Jagor. I run the Longhorn Lockpicking Club in Austin, Texas. We were founded in fall 2006, so coming up on 8 years now. I think we were one of the first, if not the first, LockSport International major chapters, sort of the flagship chapter, and now we're sort of autonomous. We kind of run our own group now. We operate out of the University of Texas at Austin.
I'm Jos Weijers. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm a member of Tool NL. That's the original Tool. Starting of this year, I'm the vice president of that group.
Ray?
I am
I'm Ray. I'm from the Sportfreunde der Sperrtechnik. It's German's Locksport group. I think the oldest Locksport group in the world, founded 1997. And yeah, doing lockpicking for
say that name one more time.
Sportfreunde der Sperrtechnik.
Yeah, it means sports friends of lockpicking, basically, in English.
There we go. I'm Babak Javadi. I'm with the Open Organization of Lockpickers in the U.S. I was one of the co-founding board members for the current form of the organization that started back in 2006. Although we've had a number of additions and departures since then. Deviant, you want to?
Sure. I'm Deviant. You may have seen me around. I'm also on the board of Tool. And yeah, I just kind of love talking about this. I love that every hope for a long time, it's been one of the first places that a lot of people saw lockpicking in the U.S. And consistently every time after that, they've had really good lockpicking talks. I think most of the people on this stage right now have been up here before in one form or another. But I don't think we've ever done this before, where we kind of, you know, we told them, we said, hey, if you want a lockpick thing, we could do that. But like, isn't intro like kind of old and busted? And they're like, no, everyone wants to learn. We're like, all right, we'll do an intro. But what if we mixed it in with other cultural lock sport topics and we took a lot more time for Q&A? And I think that's going to be really rewarding for at least us, hopefully you too. So yeah, we're going to kind of kick it off here and go with, we're going to see how this rolls.
I think before we begin, I think I wanted to recognize something interesting that I just remembered and realized here. So
what's that?
Modern lock sport as it exists in the United States today was kind of born here at Hope. I don't know if everyone has realized that before, mm-hmm. You know, the first Tool chapter before Tool was a big organization in the U.S. was started by a group of people in northern New Jersey, Eric Michaud and Mouse and a couple of others from the Princeton group. And they had been meeting, for some time before 2006. But in 2006, at Hope, actually, was when the current form of Tool in the U.S. was actually formally started. That was when we created the first board of directors for Tool. And so this is a really special experience for a lot of us because this is kind of where it all started for us. This is where it started for me. Hope was my first hacker conference. It was the first time that we started Tool formally, and it's really a pleasure and an honor to be back here again now here in 2014 talking about where we are today.
That's actually an interesting question because, as well, H2K was my first real HackerCon. Can we get a show of hands? How many people is this like your first experience with a HackerCon? Or was Hope your first one ever? Any of the Hopes? Wow, that's like half the room. That's awesome. So, yeah.
On that note, how many newcomers do we have here? Show of hands, please.
That's a lot of hands.
Good amount. That's a good amount.
It's a really cool mix. Awesome. As long as we... What is Jason Scott's? As long as we can always have the 4-star lobby and the 1-star rooms, we'll keep coming back to the Hotel Penn. So let's kind of groove through this, right? There's this intro that we like to do at some of our events, and it captures the reason people are really fascinated by locks. Even if you're not a lock picker, a lot of people love locks. They love old locks, especially. People have lock collections. Some people even just have collections of keys. So locks as a device resonate with us culturally and hold a real special place in a lot of people's hearts. And people have a hard time explaining. If you ask them, you say, why do you like this thing? You don't collect antiques. And they go, I don't know. I really like this like little, I'm going to make it into a little decoration or a token of jewelry. So locks and lock picking, it's not just about subverting security, although that's what a lot of us do professionally in other careers. Like, something just about locks is very fundamental to how we see ourselves, to how we see our culture, to how we see privacy and space. And all of this was captured pretty well in a story that a friend of ours, Skylar, used to tell. He probably still tells it if you ever see him talk. He's a very fun presenter. And Skylar says, I want you to imagine a situation where you're going to meet someone and you're supposed to be there, right? This could either be, let's say you're going to get a new place to live. You're going to go see someone's new apartment that's for rent. Or maybe you're a student. You're going to go see a professor during office hours, or you're going to just go visit friends. Like, yeah, come on over after work. I'll be there at 5:30. So you go to meet somebody, and you're supposed to be there, and it's their space. But what do you encounter? You encounter a door. And if the door is open, right, like the door is just hanging open, most of you would probably not have a real problem walking through it. At least sticking yourself a little, like you stick your head in, you're like, hey, are you here? You know, I'm here, I got here. Because again, it's an open door. So it signifies something, but it doesn't signify as much of a barrier to us culturally. Now, what if that door is shut? I bet you'd behave a little differently. Now again, we talked about this. This is either the unoccupied apartment or the professor who's supposed to be in his or her office. So you probably would knock first. I mean, culturally, that's what we learned to do as little kids. You might knock. But if it's like a door that has no lock on it, it's just, you might kind of open it. You might do that thing again where you, hey, are you out here? You know. What if the door were shut, however, and there was a lock? What would you do then? You know, it starts immediately. You're feeling something different about that door. Whether or not it's even locked. Whether or not, you know, just because there's a lock in that door, the door means something different to you. You might take your phone out. You might, before you like try to go, you might, hey, are you here? Like, I got here before you, you know? Because just because that lock is there, it means something. And even if, let's say it's that apartment rental, the landlord's like, oh yeah, I'm in traffic, but there's a little rock under a garden gnome. You can get the key and go in. Some of you might do that, and some of you might be like, oh, I'll wait for you. Because again, the lock represents something to us about space and privacy and demarking our lives. And then the really neat concluding example is, what if the door were open, but it has a lock? Now, at this point, I mean, it doesn't really matter what you personally would do, whether you'd step in or stay out or call somebody or knock or shout. I bet you that door, even though it's literally hanging open, it means something different to you than this door did that didn't have a lock in it at all. And that's part of what locks do to us, and that's part of how we like to think of them. And they're fascinating devices. We treat them as puzzles in lock sport. They're not something to be seen as just this barrier of space. They're something to be explored. As, you know, that's kind of with the hacker ethos, right? I mean, some things demark and barrier out, and we see them as things to be tinkered with. So we love to run games. We love to run contests. We have whole conferences based around this. If you get to learn lock picking, we encourage you to try your hand at any of the games. We have some here. We have some other events. A friend of ours, Shane, who really regrets he couldn't make it. He always loves hope, but you know, this is him winning like a ninja badge at DEF CON. So try your hand at contests. Some of them are fun. Some of them get really serious. We'll talk a little bit later about the competitive world of lock sport and what you see coming, people from around the world coming, the best people head to head. But that's what we're about. That's what lock sport is. It's a fun, entertaining, and hobbyist, unprofessional perhaps, non-professional way to interact with these devices that mean so very much to all of us. And if you've never picked a lock before, I think Doug and some of his people are gonna get into that. That's an empty cup, sir, I gotta fix you up.
Yes, please. I mean, I just wanna point out that our community is mostly all inclusive. And this is mostly about community. So, you know, whether it be security organizations or clubs, in your area, or lock picking, or hardware hacking, ultimately you're part of a community, and we're trying to make that community as easy and open to as many members as possible. People ask us not from this crowd, but people have asked us, you know, what differentiates you from a criminal? What differentiates you from someone that's going to break into my house that poses a threat to me? So think about that question. I'm going to answer it later, but there's quite a few differences. So I'm going to come stand on the podium. It's just,
sure. Can
so
you
it's
see
a little
the
easier.
Notes and everything?
Yeah.
Okay. All
right. So test intro to lock picking. Let's start. First thing, most important part is we do have rules, and the rules add legitimacy to our organizations and protect our members from getting into places that they shouldn't be and situations that they shouldn't be. So the first rule is, do not pick locks which you do not own. That means your dorm room, you do not own that lock. Someone else owns that lock. That includes your apartment complex. I can't stress this enough. Locks are mechanical, they're prone to failure, and if you break a lock, that you rely on especially, or which you do not own, there could be a price to pay in terms of damaged property. And along with that, do not pick locks upon which you rely. So your house lock, your car lock, padlocks that are in use. Again, mechanical devices that will break down and fail, especially when you're sticking foreign tools into a space meant for a specific shape and size. Insert your sexual innuendo there. Lock picking is easy. If you come up to the village, I promise you, we will have you opening locks within the hour. There's some things that we're going to cover that are going to make it more easy, but again, there should be a very low barrier to entry here. And that's something that we pride ourselves on. We allow people that are interested in the security community to come into conferences and spaces like these and participate in a way that they wouldn't be able to if they didn't have the experience in the computer security realm. So it's a great way to get your foot in the door. Pin tumbler locks are the majority of the locks that we're dealing with. They've been around for about a century. We're talking about 90% of the locks that you see on a daily basis. So all the locks pictured here, young and old, are pin tumbler locks. And we're going to go over the mechanism of action pin tumbler locks. So some quick verbiage here. The lock itself, or the lock housing, it can also be called the cylinder, is the whole object on the screen. The plug is the yellow piece. We have the keyway in which the key fits into, the wards that prevent only specific types of keys from entering the lock. We have the key pin, which is, we'll talk more about later, but that's that red pin. If you look into the face of a lock, into the opening of a lock, you'll see a key pin is the first pin there. So if I were to take a cross section, cut off the front of the lock, what I would see is, again, our plug, our key pin is our red pin, it makes contact with the key. Our blue pin is our driver pin. So you might ask, you know, why don't we call these bottom and top pins? And that's because in other countries, specifically in the European region, the lock is actually mounted in the 180 degrees. So in that regard, we call them key and driver pins. The entire stack is called the pin stack. If I were to attempt to open the lock with a, for instance, a tension wrench or a screwdriver, what would happen is I would have binding. I would have binding at the driver pin here. The point in which the plug meets the lock housing right here is called the shear line. So I would say the shear line is not free to move and the lock is unopenable or locked. Put the correct key in, the pin raises to the shear line, the driver pin sits above the shear line and the lock opens. Pretty standard. So most locks have several pin stacks. In this particular picture, we have five pin stacks. That's most of the residential housing in the US has a lock, a quick set, a Schlage, a cylinder that's very low security. It has five pin stacks in general. So we have locks with, you know, as little as three and as many as eight. Different levels of complexity, obviously. So insert the correct key, all the key pins raise to the correct height, the driver pins sit above the shear line, the lock can open. The cuts on the keys themselves is called the bitting. When the correct bit is cut into the key, obviously we have the shear line here. In the second position on the key, the driver pin is now sitting below the shear line because while every single pin stack is correctly at the correct position, the second one is not. This is an example of that specific bit cut too high. Again, we're binding now at the key pin instead of the driver pin. In a perfect world, if we had very, very precise manufacturing processes, and the reason why we can pick and manipulate locks open with tools that, you know, may or may not resemble a key is due to the manufacturing deficiencies in the manufacturing process. So, you know, while the assembly line is fairly accurate, the for instance, the drill bit used to jig the hole might be a little dull on this run and a little less dull on this run. So in a perfect world, if I were to draw a line down the center of the plug here, this is the plug removed from the lock, the yellow piece here, and now we're looking down onto it. What I would see in a perfect world was there would be no difference in if I were to draw a line down the center, all of the holes would align perfectly with that imaginary line that I just drew. Now, in the real world, we can see a close-up. This lock, this plug was taken out of a lock that was in very short use, but you can see very close up, there's material missing from some of the routed holes there, and they all have slightly different characteristics. So again, this is what allows us to manipulate locks open. If we look at the pins themselves, you can see there's some issues here with this pin, material missing there. So we're dealing with a material that's very soft in general. Brass is what a lot of locks are made out of. It's not the only material, but brass in particular is soft and can deform over time and can deform through heat and obviously during the manufacturing process. So again, all of these characteristics add to our ability to manipulate locks. So if in this example, I'm draw a line down the center of the plug there, what I would see is maybe the second pin stack, or that is the fourth pin stack, the hole here has a delta between that imaginary line the most. There's a largest delta between the center and the and that hole. So what happens is the plug will, while it's turning, will bind at a specific pin. And usually it's only a single pin. So what happens is we put our pick in, we feel around into the lock, we find the specific pin stack that is the most difficult to move, that has the most pressure, that has the most binding pressure from the lock, make more sense in a bit, and we move that particular pin up to the point where it picks, and we move on to the next one. So for instance, if I had a tension wrench inside the lock, I'm applying tension, and I move that specific pin that's binding up, what you'll see is the lock will turn maybe a little bit, maybe a tenth of a degree, something very minute but noticeable, and then we'll move on to the next pin. So that process in general, the essence of lock picking is being able to identify the binding pin, picking the binding pin, and then knowing that you've picked the binding pin. And this may be something that you can actually use all of your senses for. You can use sight. You may hear a clicking. Like I said, you might see, the lock rotate a tenth of a degree. So that's really the essence of the lock picking process. And obviously there's quite a bit more to learn, but with this basic knowledge set, you should be able to open, most locks that you see on a daily basis. And that's not an understatement. So.
We want to put our money where our mouth is and switch.
Absolutely, yeah. We'll stop listening to me talk for a minute. Let's get some demonstrations here.
By all means. So we'll have Babak and I. You've got a microphone. You can talk this through a little better here.
All right. So while Dave here tries to pick this lock, you'll notice that we've got a couple tools here. These are all tools from our current pick set that we have down the Lockpick Village, but already open. All right, so I can just stop talking, I guess. No, you're gonna keep going? Okay, good. So what's the most important thing with lockpicking, as many of you probably already know, is to find the right tensioner, to find the right turning tool. What you really want is a turning tool that really bites into the keyway. So for example—
Open!
Yeah, I got a cock and balls.
Open! No one noticed that you picked a lock.
So what you want is you want the thickest turning tool that actually fits in the keyway. So the less slop there is, the better feedback you get from the lock cylinder. And what that allows you to do, what Dave is doing here, is as he's applying very light turning pressure to the plug, he's able to feel both in the turning tool and in the pick tool how those pins inside the lock are behaving. So you can feel when a pin is dragging more. You can feel the grittiness of the pin. You can feel the grinding. You can feel when there's more tension or pressure against certain other pins.
Yeah, you'll see in a minute on the slides as Doug keeps talking what I'm representing here. Just really light pressure. This bad. No.
So a very common question is, well, that's great. Light pressure. What What the hell does that mean? Can you quantify that? Can you give me anything actionable, anything useful? Imagine pressing a key on a modern laptop keyboard, on a membrane keyboard. You don't require a lot of pressure to actually depress that key. That's about as much pressure you're going to be using when picking a lock, which is not very intuitive. If you apply more, what happens is the pins begin binding up more than they otherwise would, and it'll be very difficult to overcome that friction. So if you apply too much pressure, it's very difficult to pick the lock. And if you don't apply enough pressure, then you have a situation where you can't feel the binding pins. So very, very light pressure is really the key here.
Doug, tell them about what happens if they push too far.
If you push too far?
Thank you.
Hilarious. If you apply too much tension, what's going to happen is you're going to overset a pin. In this particular slide, what you're going to see is the key pin going up too high, basically going up into the cylinder or into this part of the lock, which is called the Bible. Let's wait for that animation. There we go. And it's going to get stuck, and that's oversetting or overlifting a pin in the pin stack. It may be hard to realize that you're doing that at first. Like, you know, obviously you're not going to be looking at the side of the lock when you're picking it. I think it was Josh Nekreb from Lockpicking 101 said once, lockpicking is like solving puzzles in the dark. So there's a lot of visual representation going on. It's not a sightful-based activity. So if that does happen, what we're going to do is we're going to release tension on the lock, we're going to reset the lock, and then we're going to start over. I like to tell beginners in particular, if you haven't picked the lock within 20, 30, 40 seconds, you should probably reset the lock and start over.
If it's an easier lock. I mean, not every lock is going to open in 20, 30, 40 seconds.
For beginners. For me, at least.
This is why I love the idea of this panel.
I can open
it. Our whole deal
was
like sniping at each other on shit we disagree on. Just like some of us are every time you say the word tension, I'm like dying. Oh. Those of us who are sticklers, you know, tension is attractive force, and like it's turning tool.
Okay, yeah. We'll use torque from now on to make DB
even
happy.
That sounds too bad.
But for you guys that want to come on down to Lockpick Village later and try, don't use that 30-second benchmark as a oh no, I can't open it in 30 seconds. Yeah. I'm terrible.
Well, if one of our staff doesn't open the lock in 30 seconds, you can like throw those little black rockets at us.
Well, there's other things you can blame on the lock if it's not opening in 30 seconds, so you'll learn to do that as well.
Sage advice, if it doesn't open in 30 seconds, blame the lock.
What was the name of the book that
that's how
by Mark
made it
Tobias?
This far.
Oh yeah, Tobias's book was open in 30 seconds, so
told
yeah.
You, right.
That's the standard, right?
Anyways.
Other tools,
let's keep going. So, there's another method of opening locks called the raking method. Not something we generally teach, but it is kind of a brute force method of opening a lock, and more of a random method.
Technique. It's not all random.
Yeah, well, I teach this all the time. It's way easier.
I don't teach it. If you want to learn how to pick locks, you're going to do it the right way, or you're not going to do it at all.
So, yeah, as you can see, well, the reason there's the controversy here, so rake tools are usually, their working head is longer, and they touch multiple pin stacks simultaneously. That's kind of a feature of raking. So it doesn't lend itself to a deliberate finesse process of I'm touching this pin, what do I feel under this pin? It's literally just scrub, 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 and open. And for all of the freaking like nerdy people in the room, someone who saw it once, they saw like lifting, and it's, we're picking, it took a while, and then they saw raking, and they were like, we're blowing through everything. Like I was raking some of those earlier. And they're like, oh, so raking is more powerful. And I said, no, not more powerful, just more seductive. So it is.
Raping.
Like, yeah.
Raping.
No.
That's what it looks like.
My analogy is
not good.
A rake is, it's basically like an automatic transmission. And a lifting pick, a hooking pick, it's like a stick shift. This is another good show of hands question for this room, because it's not like your usual crowd of people in this country anymore. How many people can drive a stick shift in this room? There you go. So if you learned to drive a car, and you learned on a stick shift, we got the camera? Oh well. If you learned on a stick shift, you can always get behind the wheel of an automatic if like your buddy's drunk at a party and you gotta drive it home. But if you learned on an automatic and then you get behind the wheel of someone's car and you're like, why are there three pedals? Like, it kind of screws you up. So we encourage, as Doug would say, we encourage people to try the finesse technique and to learn good pick discipline first with lifting. Then, like Babak and I, you know, we own a pen testing company. Like, how many times do we start with raking? Always.
All of the times.
Because I want to get in the door before the guard comes around the corner.
Right. And so if
same
you,
with competition, everybody will start off.
Of course. Absolutely. Even in our championships at, you know, at LockCon and at other events, everyone starts with raking. You know, a couple swipes with raking first.
He's like shaking his head.
The thing is, though, if you waste your time raking...
I'm going to talk over Doug right now. Jagor, tell me, how far did raking get me in the competition at LockCon last year?
So, last year you did pretty good.
I did pretty good.
Sixth in the world, I think.
In our competition. Obviously, not everyone in the world would come to our competition.
That gets an applause right there, honestly.
We did. So, the reason I bring that up is because will raking get you into every lock? No. But if you understand enough about how locks work and how they respond, you can learn how to use a brute force technique and add your own kind of finesse into it. So you can learn very quickly if a lock is going to respond to raking or not. And so it looks very random. If you look at someone who is not very experienced and someone who is very experienced and you look at what they're doing when they're raking, it looks identical. But for the person who's actually doing the picking, it feels very different. I can tell, you know, and after the competition, Jagor actually asked me, he's like, Babak, what the fuck? Like, raking, I've always just thought is silly. How is it that, you know, what are you doing? How is it that it's working? And for me, I can say that whenever I'm raking a lock, I can actually feel the lock it feels different. It begins to respond differently, and I can tell that I'm getting somewhere. And that's something that you gain with experience. So if you just start learning with only raking, then yeah, you're not necessarily learning a whole lot about how lock is going to respond. But if you combine the techniques, you can become very, very proficient at opening locks quickly.
I don't know. I don't know what's up with the camera, but oh well.
No, it's two cycles.
Oh, it's two. Oh, yeah. See, there we go.
You got to turn it off and on again.
Yeah. Hello, IT. You want to try to rake that one?
Yeah. So we'll try this blue master lock here really quick.
While you guys are attempting to scrub the lock open, let me ask Jagor another question. When you won first place at DEF CON and had all-inclusive paid trip to the Netherlands to compete, what was your method of opening the lock?
So historically, I've been sort of a purist. You can rake a lock open, but I consider it a dishonorable victory. So my pick set is just full of short hooks here. I focus almost exclusively on single pin picking. So that's what I did for the U.S. Championship.
And we're proud of you for it.
I think the real point there was that if you get good enough, you get your trips paid for to come compete in the Netherlands.
Yeah. Well, like, who wants a free trip to Amsterdam and then a train ride to Snake? Get good at picking.
Especially the train ride to Snake.
Yeah. All right. So, halftime.
What was that?
Halftime and stuff.
It's been an hour and a half.
No.
Halftime?
Half diamonds.
Half diamonds, sorry. I'm saying halftime. Like, this isn't the Super Bowl. Not like we'd be watching it anyways.
It's better.
So several different tools. We've talked about these already, but let's just put them into context. This is our short hook or our what do you call the short hook?
Short hook.
A hook.
Feeler
hook. A what?
Just a hook.
A hook? Okay.
In between the long hook and the gonzo.
Or feeler. That's what I was getting at, feeler.
Sure. Hook, feeler. Everyone feeler, has different names for them. It's whatever.
We're getting as central as we can
here. I gave a whole
here.
Talk just about pick terminology at DerbyCon, and if you speak Spanish, I gave a talk at Echo Party. The videos are online. There's like a billion terms for all the picks that are out there, and half of them are describing the same pick.
All right. So anyways, you'll hear many different terms for the same stuff, and don't let it overwhelm you. Again, oops, this is obviously the hook-like pick, so that's all you need to remember. We have the half diamond, Notable characteristic of the half diamond is it's a straight pick all the way from the base of the pick to the end of the pick, and that we'll talk about why that's important later. And then we have our rake, and again, like Deviant said, there's about a million different types of rake styles, but anything that doesn't look like these two, you can just call a rake. There are some ridiculous names, double, triple snowman, I don't even, anyone have any good names?
King and queen picks.
King and queen picks, okay. So anyone can come up with a pick design and, you know, name it something ridiculous.
So we're going to show you some different rakes here.
Nobody with a C or C.
So, for example, here's, you know...
Stuff you should throw away.
Why don't you go through the names here?
So, yeah, I mean, the classic triple hump or Fogota, because it's not quite a Bogota like this one. You have the dual hump Sabana, P-knuckle, another P-knuckle. It's interesting that all of us have moved to the really severe raking profile compared with, like, this is, you know, the long jag, the L-rake, or the old-fashioned, like the one on the slides that you saw earlier, the sort of just the C rake or S rake or snake or, yeah, here we got one here. So that was, you know, how many people, if again, show your hands if you have a pick kit that ever had this pick in it. Like, it came with every pick set along with that stupid single ball. But now, like, almost all the rake profiles have moved to this Raimundo-style, very severe humped tool that originally started out with his Bogota set and has been knocked off and copied any number of times over.
Can someone tell me what that those severe or very deep cuts? What that resembles?
You're asking them or us?
I don't mean.
Are you talking about this?
Anyone thing? Who understands what I'm talking
You're not
about,
making boobs as a
please
joke
answer.
Or something, right?
No, it yeah. resembles a bump key, right?
Yeah, kind of.
We
yeah.
have very deep cuts, so just a note.
But yeah, I mean, just all of those and more. There's tons of raking tools out there, and their whole idea is to get a lot of pins moving with a lot of randomness as much as you can, as fast as you can. But this is a fun thing that doesn't involve rakes.
Right, so our half diamond, the characteristic I was talking about earlier is we can put it in the cylinder, we can put it in the cylinder what we would think of as upside down, and we can raise it up as high as we can, so the springs are completely retracted. And when we slowly pull the pick out of the lock, what's going to happen is we're going to hear the pins slamming down. If there's five pins, you're going to hear slam, 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 slam. And that gives you an idea not only how many pins are in the lock, but it also helps you visually represent how close the pins are to each other and how close the tolerances are in that regard. So very useful. Before you get to the point where you're, you know, just looking at a lock and you know every single characteristic about it just by looking at it, this is a good learning exercise. So several people have mentioned this already, but one of the most important tools is your turning tool. Someone said, I don't recall who, but someone said that picking is 90% tension and 10% tool selection usage. So what that means is, you know, the tension is very, very important. When I pick, and I know a lot of people do this as well, they put the lock in the palm of their hand, the keyway facing either direction, it doesn't matter, but the palm goes in the palm of your hand, the tension wrench goes to the bottom or top of the keyway, and the index finger completely extended is used to, that was a trip, sorry. The index finger is used to apply tension to the lock. So that is the way you should be replicating as well. If you look at your finger and there's blood leaving the tip.
Like that.
I mean, not only are you gonna wear out your hand, your hand is gonna start to hurt. You know, that's too much tension, you're applying too much tension. The lock's
turning
gonna have
pressure.
A very hard time opening. So, save yourself by being gentle. This is really important. And oftentimes, what happens is people will go at this very seriously. They'll start picking for the first time, and they'll...
That's not a staged photo, too.
This is what they look like.
Those people.
That, right, okay. Anyways, so the point that I'm trying to make is oftentimes you'll give up hope very quickly. No pun intended, but you'll give up and you'll start just messing with the lock subconsciously. You'll engage in a conversation with your neighbor. You'll start thinking of something else. You'll turn on the TV and the lock will fall open in your hands and you'll be like, what did I just do? The first time you do open a lock, you do kind of feel like God. It's really cool. All these doors literally will open in front of your eyes once you know how to pick cloth. I mean, it's really a powerful tool if used in the right manner. So I'm going to let Deeves talk about this particular slide.
Yeah, so like happy kittens, right? Of course. I'm a cat owner. My cats are at a friend's house because I'm moving. But yeah, so obviously when you get a lock open, we haven't actually been respecting this enough up here, but it's like, open, you gotta say, open, or if you're Ray, you say, offen. And then all the Dutch guys go, grr, German, beat me. So yeah, like, tell us, you know, that's the big thing in this culture is the idea of like, open. We wanna hear it when you get locks open in the village. We'll try to say it more up here. It looks like we're showing off, but that's the idea. What would prevent this from working? What would prevent a lock from opening? Well, there are pick-resistant locks. So seeing what you have, how many of you, again, I love the hands because I love the audience. Mechanically, did that diagram make sense? Like it's clear, you understand those imperfections, you understand how they bind and why they happen. Well, if lock picking, essentially lock picking is an inversion of the normal way you interact with a lock, right? Normally, you push the pins with the key, then you turn. It's push, then turn. Lock picking is just turn, then push. So it's mechanically, it's a very simple process, and you did a beautiful explanation of it. Well, what could interfere with that process? What could interfere with the idea of picking? Pick-resistant pins are an easy way that manufacturers can stop this sort of mechanical action of turn first. If you have a pin that's not a pure cylinder, if it's in this case spool-shaped, like a little spool of thread, this is called a spool pin, the idea would be turning pressure causes that lip to kick over. It causes that lip to splay out to the side, and then if you try to turn and then lift, that spool pin isn't actually going to let you lift correctly. Now, that doesn't mean it's impossible, right?
Well, it just makes it more challenging eventually, right? The lock manufacturers use these, they don't use them widespread because it is more expensive, obviously, to manufacture these more precise, pins in general, but once you understand how they operate, it really just adds another piece to the puzzle, and it makes it more exciting and more fun, and you get to keep moving on once you've mastered the basic pin tumbler lock. So these aren't something to be afraid of. There's something to embrace and conquer and you know, learn the different intricacies of the pins themselves. And so I wanted to say something earlier. Well, I don't remember. Continue.
Okay. So the idea, when people first see this diagram, they say, wow, so it like it jams it up and, you know, you can't get by it, can you? Well, let's look at it a little more closely. And I'm just going to imagine what's happening over my shoulder because of presenter mode. But when the pin is jammed up, when the plug is turned and the spool is caught on a lip, you have the contact points between the driver pin, that blue pin, and the key pin in red. They're very splayed apart. If you push a little harder underneath on that pin, the mechanical action, what the pins want to do is kind of bring that gap back to true a little bit. So the two black lines that show some rotational position here, you can see it gets kicked over, it gets jammed up, and then if you push a little harder underneath the spool pin that's binding, you can get the plug to actually back rotate just a hair. And that will, you know, occlude that gap shut, and then you can kind of pop around the spool. Now, a few things are going to happen there. One, you need even less pressure on that turning tool. And we got into some of the analogies. I love your analogy. Bobbix explains the turning pressure. Normally, think of like a keyboard, like a membrane keyboard, a laptop keyboard, less pressure than you need on that key. Think of if the turning tool were flat, just stacking some coins on it, that's enough pressure. Even less pressure than that is what you're doing if you're trying to get past a spool. Extra pressure underneath, which we told you earlier, you might overlift, you might jam up. But all of that, the most frustrating thing is that back rotation can cause pins you had set to then unset in other chambers. So spools are quite the frustration all around, but it is absolutely possible to get by them. It's possible to probe for them, to find out where they might be. A lot of times you'll hear people, if you know, you pass them, hey man, this lock's a real pain in the ass. There's a spool in chamber three. Like, you know, people will talk to each other about that. But getting around them, it is possible.
That's an example of the kind of information you would only get picking pin by pin. Mm-hmm. So you're not going to be able to tell which pin chamber has a spool if you're just raking. You might be able to tell their spools, but you won't be able to tell where they are.
You're not helping your argument. Sorry.
So there's a lot of pick-resistant pins. There's a lot of interesting designs.
Open
a mushroom pin. The idea is if you make the pick-resistant pin with sides that will drag more along the plug wall, this will create longer periods of friction. Obviously, what's the disadvantage here? Well, that pin is not reversible. Spool pins, a giant machining operation can load them into a hopper. And as the lock plugs are coming along and the housing's coming along an assembly line, a machine can just feed them down. Something like a mushroom pin, this is something a locksmith is ordering and he or she is pinning by hand, and they're actually orienting things correctly. Serrated pins, I don't know how well this shows up on the screen for y'all in the back, but like just pins that have grooves down the entire thing. There was a famous lock picker and locksmith named Jerry Finch. He worked with Lab and other companies later on. He was a huge advocate for spool pins. And in the latest proof of concept, or get the fuck out, the one that Travis Goodspeed puts out, I wrote an article about spool pins and how Jerry advocated actually scoring the inside of your plug walls to make them jam up even harder. Speaking of that, some companies have really done micro machining, and like there's a Swedish company, Asa. Asa loves to make this crazy-ass pin, which Hanfei, our friend from Holland, calls the sneaky pin. It's, you know, basically a double spool, but look at the plug. The plug has little counter-milled notches right at the top of its chambers that cause positive lockup. This is the old Asa 700. It's an old lock. I think there's, what, like four or five people in the world that might be crazy or drunk enough to pick this? Like, Arthurmeister probably would try. And then he would yell and throw it and talk to Marina. But it's possible to do really interesting things just with your basic pin tumbler design. It's going to cost a lot more, because that's a question we get a lot too. People say, oh, those imperfections, well, couldn't you just make the lock, you know, more precise? Yeah. You couldn't sell it at Home Depot for $10. You know, there's a difference between a CAD diagram and a piece of metal in your hand. Anybody can make a CAD diagram and be like, I'm Bob's Lock Company and I'm going to make locks. Then you call the factory and you say, hello, I want to make locks. And they say, wait, ni chile ma.
No,
you
forgot.
Say, oh, I need someone who speaks Mandarin.
You forgot the part that you start a Kickstarter first.
Yeah, you start a Kickstarter and make locks, exactly.
Right.
Better than lock picks. But yeah, like you're going to be on the phone with somebody at a factory that's going to say, well, what are your machining tolerances? How precise is this engineering? And if you want the, oh, I want them down to like, you know, the 10 microns. And they're like, okay, we can do that. Your supply part cost is $500. And you're like, wow, I'm trying to sell these for $4.99 on the corner bodega. So that's why all this happens. It's a trade-off of cost and engineering. And how often do we encounter spool, like in the U.S., what would you guys say? Like maybe half the locks you encounter in a commercial environment might have a spool in what? Like
much less than that.
Yeah. Oh, residential, you're not getting spools except for one or two like nice brands.
And it opens up the
lock. Yost has a really screwed up look on his face right now because he's like, seriously?
What are the locks like in Holland?
The reason we say that is because, Yost, what would you say in the EU, what percentage of locks, even the cheap ones that you buy, you know, like Castorama or something, how many of those have spool pins?
Well, if you go to the equivalent of, let's say, Home Depot in the Netherlands, the lower shelf, maybe not. That's about it.
But everything else is going to have spool pins.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, if you buy them at, less than a fiver, then there's a chance they won't have a spool pin. That's about it.
And there's an important point here, too, is that not everybody needs super high security locks. Yet, generally, when you go to more populated areas like the EU, the several urban areas in the U.S., the cities, you're going to find higher security locks just by nature of the need for more security. And the same thing applies in the cybersecurity world as well.
We're just a much more secure country. We don't need all those crazy spool pins. That's
we
what the NSA
guns.
Told me.
Europe doesn't.
NSA told me that you don't need spool pins. Don't worry. It's okay.
You have guns.
We're here to protect you.
It's also important to say that even though these layers have been added to the lock to prevent you from opening them, they do not prevent against all types of attacks when you talk, you know, holistically about security and locks in general. There are many other attacks that even the most precisely manufactured locks that may be very, very, very hard to pick open will be vulnerable to other attacks like bumping, which we'll slightly touch on in a little bit. So if you're talking about security, again, in the holistic sense, you know, we're talking about specific areas or specific types of vulnerabilities.
Yeah. So Doug Farr with an excellent intro. Thank you, Doug. Don't forget that. That's the important thing. So there's another topic now. This is not so much about opening locks. Well, I guess in a way it is. In a bit. So there's an interesting ethical discussion that it kind of never really happened across a lot of groups and across a lot of, other than a few posts on a mailing list. The topic of love picking is something we wanted to bat around for a minute and then even get your feedback and talk about, especially in a city like New York. So I don't know how familiar people are in this room with the idea of love locks, this notion that it was originally in an Italian film, like this bad romance movie, where a young couple, you know, puts a lock on a bridge and, you know, they throw the key away. And because of this film, this phenomenon has grown. It started to spread originally through parts of Europe, and then it became really popular around other places.
Raise your hand if you've seen this
in
person.
Like, how many people have
it's
seen, maybe not this.
It's reasonably popular.
So this has become a huge cultural phenomenon, and it's become a phenomenon here, even in the U.S.
How much does that fence weigh right now?
Yeah.
You know, that looks
like... It's a problem. The bridge wasn't designed to carry that many locks and people at the same time.
Yeah, so like things like this happen.
To me, that looks like a lot of free locks.
Well, that's part of
the discussion, basically.
Yeah.
That's my view.
So, these are a lot of us who love locks, who enjoy them, I should say, who enjoy locks in general, think love locks are beautiful. We think it's a cool sentiment. We think it looks gorgeous. Like Skyler, he's a fanatic for love locks. He has all these great photos, but municipalities do not agree. So, cities actually consider this a maintenance problem. They consider it a public nuisance. Here in New York and other places, especially, they just have crews that go around and cut these locks off of bridges very regularly. And if you walk across the Williamsburg Bridge or the Brooklyn Bridge, you'll see like shackles that are kind of thrown around because they're trying to collect all these locks and there are these droppings that occur. So there's become a new movement called love picking. And the idea, it's very mixed. So some people are just non-romantics, and they just want to, you know, open locks and be like, screw you, lovers. And other people are very territorial.
They've had their hearts broken.
So, like, Sean Nichols and the Irish Cats in Love Lock No More in Dublin, the Haypenny Bridge, they pick just to, like, clean their bridge. They think it's a public space issue. And other, like, in Tool, we skirt the middle ground. We pick some locks, or we did until there was a big boardroom Skype call where people were upset. And we did it to preserve the locks because we thought they were gorgeous and thought it was a shame they were being thrown away.
There's two core philosophies here that are at odds with each other, and this is where we'd like your opinion in the audience. On one hand, you have from the lock picker's perspective, look at all these great and sometimes really beautiful locks that are just going to be cut, right? So this is a maintenance issue. The cities are cutting them. Wouldn't it be nice if instead we save these locks by picking them and then reusing them in perhaps another art installation or something like that? The other perspective, the other side of this is, well, you don't own those locks. Those locks don't belong to you. And even though they've been abandoned, it is not your charge to pick them open and take them off. You shouldn't be the person doing that.
Rule number one applies.
Right, exactly. Don't pick locks you don't own. And that's an honorable and worthy rule as well. So, again, these two sides are at odds with each other because at the end of the day, the locks are going to go. They're either going to be cut or they're going to be picked or the original owners are going to come back and, you know, if they still have the key for some reason, maybe they found the key on the bottom of the river, they open it again or for some reason. But this is the question at hand right now.
Yeah, like look at these. These are just a small sampling of the locks that Tool has preserved and some of our friends have preserved over the years. These all would have been thrown away. These all would have been in a dumpster. And instead, each one of them has been wrapped in basically red felt and put in the Tool office, waiting for the culmination of a project that we'll tell you about in a minute. Before we tell you about that project, Ray is going to tell you about an interesting project for two or three slides here.
Yeah, and I had the problem of, what a problem, but I wanted to give a love lock to a friend of mine who got married.
Oh,
and I
cable.
Didn't want
Where's
to,
the cable?
We can change to here. Wanted to rely on the moral discussion of the people coming to the bridge with the lock hangs. So I thought, oh, let's look inside the mechanism. I'll go back to the slide. Okay. The slide is not there.
One more time. Press
no, we lost the screen for a second.
Deviant lost the screen.
Oh,
drink.
Okay, the first thing I realized is that...
There we go.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so the plug and the mechanical part of the lock which operates the shackle are divided by a space, and there are two interacting parts. So I thought I can just saw them off and put a spacer between. So in this lock here...
Yeah, so do you guys see that plug no longer operates the operating cylinder at all now? Like, it's completely divorced.
The cam has been disconnected.
Yeah, the cam is disconnected. So this looks like a real lock.
Yeah, so, and you can easily engrave them with a laser cutter. So I basically engraved the locks, this is here for the conference, but the other one I engraved, of course, with the names of the couple, and detached the plug from the upper part. So you can pick the lock as often as you want, but it won't open the lock anymore. So I don't have to care about the moral issues of the people coming to the bridge. And if you want to try, I'll actually put one of these locks somewhere here at the conference, I think near the lock-picking area. I think it can be opened by manipulating somehow my returning disk, but have a look at it. Have
All
fun.
Right. So very cool, the super love lock, apparently. But, so people asked us, when we were on the Brooklyn Bridge and other bridges, people asked us a lot. They said, hey, what are you out here? Because there's a real, how many people, if you liked a love lock and you saw someone picking it, you might be like, hey, what are you doing? That's my representation of forever and poetry and birds, you know? So.
Well, now, there's a lot of people laughing, but I do feel that there's probably a very significant number of people who feel just as strongly.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm not trying to dismiss, but I'm a romantic at heart, you know.
And you have to remember, every time you pick a love lock, the couple gets divorced.
That's the reason.
Some people are more sentimental than others.
So when people asked us, why are you doing this, why, and we would explain, you realize if we don't cut these off, like the city of New York, the Port Authority is going to cut these off. They're going to throw them away. And they said, well, why is it any better that you're picking them? Well, Moscow, Russia has started something, and I don't know of it in any other cities yet. We've reached out, that is to say, I've reached out to the press and public relations offices of the New York Department of Transportation and Port Authority, not getting any response. But we love the idea of this, of love lock trees. So a bridge in Moscow was very weighted with locks and it was a problem. And they had a public, installation of art. They had a metal worker make this gorgeous metal tree and they installed it right on the foot of the bridge. And they encouraged people to put their locks on the tree instead. And they said, look, you can put them on the bridge. Like, we might ticket you if we see you, which is currently in New York. You can get in trouble for putting them on the bridge. But they said, if you put them on the bridge, ticket or not, like, they're going to get cut off. They're going to get thrown away. If you put them on the tree, it lives there forever. And I think that is gorgeous. It's to our mission. If there's anybody out there who has any pull, like, we got journalists here. It's a great human interest story. Come on. Get someone on the phone from the Bridge Commission or from, New York Department of whomever. We will raise funds for this. We will work with public metal workers for this and the steel workers and the artisans. We want to see, like, literally a tree rusts in Brooklyn. Like, that's what we want to see. We want to see a love lock tree. And if one of these gets erected, all the locks we picked, we're going to put on the tree kind of as starter locks, and other people will see it. And hopefully, I think it's freaking beautiful. But other than that, the idea of whether it's ethical, like, love locks keep spreading. Yep. And I don't know how the trend ends. I don't know what cities are going to do. And I don't know what people think is right and wrong. But there's got to be a key to solving this issue.
Key.
And I'd like to hear from the panel. Yeah, I'd like to hear from you guys.
I totally agree on the beauty of that tree. I mean, that's a very good alternative. But that doesn't mean we're allowed to pick the locks that are on the bridge. That's my opinion. Mm-hmm. I mean, the Dutch chapter is a bit more strict on this one. We see it as the same as taking a lock from a bridge, a love lock from a bridge. It equals to stealing coins from a wishing well. And it's metal, and somebody put that in there with some significance in their point of view. And we're taking it away. And yes, the locks will be taken away eventually, anyhow, even without us doing it. But now we're not. Because, well, the ground rules of picking start with, do not pick a lock that you don't owe or have specific permission from the owner of picking it. And, well, the question is the bridge owner the owner of the lock that happens to be on that bridge? So I think the media, the potential media shitstorm that we're undoing some holy bond between two people, I don't want that. So I'm quite against it.
Yeah.
Sorry. There's questions.
You said the crowd mic working? We'll repeat your question if it's not.
Yes. Okay. So you said that you were reaching out to the city about this. I mean, what if you guys reached out to cities to say, let's cooperate, let's make this a thing? You're going to cut them off anyway. Mm-hmm. Let's make it a thing and make it publicly known that instead of cutting them off, people will lockpick them, and they will either get lockpicked or they will get... So it's a known thing, and it's a, you know, it's within the realm of permission.
It's because a shallow line.
What's the difference between, you know, picking it or cutting it off if everybody knows that you have permission to do so?
Well, I'm not going to cut them off.
No, that's the difference.
No, I'm not going to cut them off.
The city is going to cut them
off. Sure, they can do that.
If you're already cooperating with the city, so, right. Like, instead of you guys cutting them off, let us go and pick them for you as a service to the city.
Look at how
you're saving the city money.
I think that's a far-fetched idea that any city would align themselves with a hacking organization.
It's a beautiful idea.
It's wonderful. There was an example of a town in, I think, California that published a hackathon in Oakland, weekly newsletter saying, come learn how to pick locks. And the media backlash of the city aligning with an organization that was teaching lockpicking was just unbelievable.
All right. Well, here's some more backstory on that, because I think.
We can talk about this for a second.
We can talk about this for a second because Tool was the organization that was affected by this directly. So in the city of Oakland, California, which, as you guys know, has a very, very low crime rate and is known for its safety, there's some workshop weekends. They do a lot of science-y, hacky stuff to, you know, share knowledge and, you know, kind of encourage the idea of learning and stuff like that.
From learn to solder to, right, like baking in the kitchen.
All sorts of stuff, you know, biohacking and this and that. And one of the workshops that our San Francisco chapter was doing was about lockpicking, which is cool, right? Now, the mayor had a newsletter, her office, rather, had a newsletter that, you know, promotes local community events.
Just stuff going on in Oakland.
Stuff going
really
on
pasted
in Oakland.
With a lot of mismatched font, you know, just copy-paste.
Now, imagine you're just looking for cool stuff going on in your city to post in the newsletter, and someone in the office saw, oh, cool, lockpicking. Yeah, that's cool. We'll put that on the newsletter. So then all the residents in the city of Oakland received this newsletter that said, hey, residents of this city that is having so many problems with crime, please come learn how to pick locks. And I think, as you can imagine, there was concern in the community. The act of learning how to pick locks by itself, of course, does not make you a criminal, but It was a sensitive issue, and perhaps it wasn't dealt with in the newsletter in the most politically correct way, I guess is a good way of putting it. And so that resulted in some
that resulted in local press, which then resulted in regional press, which is Bay Area. And I don't know if anyone came in from the West Coast, but what is the number one, not number one, what is like the number three priority of the San Francisco press? Pissing all over Oakland and saying how much better San Francisco is. So yeah, it was the San, who was that dick, Chip or Skip, whatever his, somebody in the San Francisco Chronicle made a huge, you know, hit piece about it and how Mayor Jean Kwan doesn't know what she's doing, and it turned into this massive, oh my God, I can't believe the crimes, the terrors.
For like a day.
Yeah, for like a day, and then it died
out. People got bored.
So the idea of lockpicking as a topic in general really fans a lot of flames of, it gets people very impassioned. And it happens with love locks, it happens with workshops. How many of you go home from a HackerCon and you say, oh, I bought a set of lockpicks, I could, you know, my brother or sister, let me teach young Timmy. And they're like, hey, what are you teaching my child? You know, it's a very hot topic issue. So yeah, I mean, we heard from Jos, we heard, our view on it was that these are abandoned property. That's how we told ourselves, maybe we were not being honest with ourselves, if you want to be critical of us. We told ourselves that it wasn't violating the law of don't pick locks you don't own, because we said, well, what if it's like, don't, you know, there's, these are locks like no one owns. They're just kind of, they're just abandoned property. So I don't know if that's a stretch. I would really like to hear more from what people think. And is that a hand there? Or, yeah, go ahead, sir.
Mike.
We'll repeat too. Go ahead.
You know, when people fish, they'll have like catch and release. Have you ever thought of just picking the lock and then putting it back? You know,
yeah.
To maintain the symbolism.
Catch and release.
Yeah, well, there's a problem with that. I mean, if you're halfway picking, you're picking. So if people question you then, I know there's a story about ethics. That's a story that did not happen. Let's start off with that. It was a thought process that Skylar explained me once that made perfectly sense. Imagine you're driving along to an interstate or whatever it's called here, and it's dark and it's late, and you end up, you pass a store that is closed. You have money. You want a soda. You see the soda behind the locked door. You have the money. So I'll just pick this door open and exchange the soda for money and pick the door closed again. With all the best intentions in the world, I wouldn't go there.
Yeah. That's a cool analogy, yeah.
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 So maybe we can do an informal poll. I mean, this is not a proper sample because we have a probably very skewed sample here of the populace, I would say. In a good
very,
way.
Very but ethical people here.
I think so.
Yeah.
I do.
So, you don't have to if you don't want to, but if you think that we should stick to the Netherlands original rule book and say, you know what, you don't own the lock, it's not your lock, you didn't put it there, don't pick it. Even if someone else is going to cut it, don't pick it. Who thinks that's the way we should be operating?
Right? Stick to
that's
the number
that's a significant portion. Okay.
And how about the furthest of the other end of the spectrum, what we deluded ourselves a bit saying, this is abandoned property, and if we're doing it for an ethical reason to preserve them, it's okay to pick them. Anybody?
It's about the same.
A little more there, yeah. I'd like to think, but you know.
I think in the middle way would be, and that's very elaborate, is if somebody would come up to me and said, me and my girlfriend, or me and my boyfriend, whatever, we have a lock that's on that bridge.
Yeah.
We know it's going to cut. Please join me to opening
I
that.
I thought you were going
to
say, we broke up, so can you help me?
Miss,
you have a question as well, please. Or a comment.
So my comment is that picking a lock that somebody else has put there is kind of like cutting off a bike from where it's been connected. Not that I have any judgment one way or the other, because that could be an abandoned bike. But people might come back for their lock.
Yeah.
They might do it symbolically and then come back a year later and want it. So there's, I have no moral connection, but I just wanted to give some...
That's a valid point. And we actually haven't said this publicly. Thank you, Biz. We haven't really mentioned it. After the talk we had, Tool doesn't participate in any love picking days anymore. We've been leaving the bridges alone. We are just waiting to hear back from the city and from the public. And we're really ultimately waiting for a love lock tree. That's what we really hope to find. But that's where everything stands right now. And gentlemen, yes, and then we'll move on to impressioning.
So when you get the love lock tree, if and when that does indeed happen, picking them from the bridge and relocating them to the tree doesn't create an ethical issue, correct?
I don't know if it does or not.
Here's my thought. So I think from the perspective of the people who put the locks there, if the lock is being placed there as a symbolic gesture, then it's irrelevant if the lock can be picked or cut. That's not why you put it there, right? I mean, obviously you know that it can be cut. You know that in theory it could be picked. You place the lock there because it represents something intangible. It represents something that you can't... It's a physical representation of something that is only a thought, an idea, a feeling. Having someone pick it open, just because the lock is still physically there, the fact that it's been picked open for a lot of those people might feel that, you know, something has been hurt or damaged in some way. And that's what we want to be sensitive to. So my personal take is, if this is something that is to succeed, this is what would have to happen. We would have to get the cooperation of a municipality. They would have to install the trees and say, like, okay, you know, and make a big media thing out of it. These are the trees where, like, if you're a couple and you want to place a love lock somewhere, please place it on this tree. On these trees that we've created for this purpose. The bridges were not designed for this purpose. It does cause damage. It costs us money. It costs you, the taxpayer, money. Please don't do that. We're going to use the trees. And at some point in the future, on such and such a date or after such and such a time, we'll be removing all the locks from the bridge. Any that can be picked will be moved to the tree. Otherwise, the locks will be removed and destroyed. And if you announce that, you know, and leave, like, you know, a year of time or something like that, I think, in my opinion, that's kind of a happy middle ground. But I think the idea of just kind of back-channeling communication, going to the city saying, hey, you guys mind if we pick these locks? And they're like, ah, sure, whatever. That gives the original owners zero time to respond and say, well, no, I don't want you to pick that. If anything, I'm going to come back and take the lock myself.
Well, at the risk of being insensitive, I just want to ask, are we really to the point where sentiment is more important than wasting a huge amount of resources, regardless of
yes,
the
we do
situation.
That all the time.
But
all the time.
Okay, well, I guess I'm a realist. But.
Libertarians.
Yeah. Just one more point from my view. I'm from Germany, and we have a beautiful bridge over the River Rhine in Cologne, mm-hmm. with hundreds of thousands of locks. Meanwhile, it's a security issue. They have to go, because the bridge is used by trains, and they have tripled the way.
Yes,
meanwhile.
It's a real problem,
and it's
absolutely.
A real thing, and
it's
they
true,
have
but
to
it's
go.
It's not
and,
something and from, that a sports group should solve.
Sorry, and I think they have to go, and if somebody decides they have to go for security reasons, in my opinion, it's better than one of you guys or a couple of you guys go there and take the locks away, instead of the fire brigade or somebody else who cuts them away.
Thank you. As a hobbyist sports lock picker, some of us still feel that the city is not able to give that permission for us to open that lock. It would have to be the person who put the lock on, regardless of whether they were allowed to put that lock there. We as hobbyist lock pickers have a code of ethics that we follow very strictly, and some of us don't feel like we're allowed to open that lock for any reason.
I would like to ask Jagor and Jos something. What if a municipality came and said, we're going to hire, not us, what if they hire a locksmith to remove the locks non-destructively? Would they be allowed to do that?
They're not bound by our code of ethics.
Okay.
I mean, if the police ask you to open up a door because some criminals are in, that's valid, yeah.
What if we, some people within the organization were hired at zero charge by the locksmith temporarily as in a professional capacity, as an official employee on paper,
temporary
and
apprentice?
Then that company was contracted by the city to remove the locks?
That's frowned upon. If you're wearing a tool shirt, it'll
get it sounds you. Like you're not acting as a hobbyist lockpicker at that point. You're okay. becoming a temporary yeah. locksmith.
Okay, all right. So it's, maybe that's part of where the line is whether you're acting as a hobbyist lockpicker.
It's gray.
It's gray, yeah. Sure. But we're trying to figure out where that line yeah. is.
I don't like gray in this area. So that's, ethics shouldn't be gray.
Well, that's just the nature of ethics.
Well,
but it shouldn't be.
The debate about ethics should always be gray, and then eventually.